have your Bibles with you this evening, please turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Now, 1 Corinthians 13 contains a lot of stuff that we talk about and a lot of stuff that we remember because most people use 1 Corinthians 13 for two reasons. One, it's the go-to passage when you get married, right? Love does this, love doesn't do that. And the second reason is because it's kind of like the hallmark verse for talking about spiritual, miraculous gifts. But I'd like to frame it this way in 1 Corinthians 13. Let's set the context. As we talked about this morning, the church is one body with many members with one mission. That's the church in a nutshell. And as we looked at the context this morning in 1 Corinthians, we see that this is a place where Corinth in and of itself isn't exactly a bastion of morality, so to speak. It's actually the opposite of that. And as I noted this morning, we're not just talking about the culture outside of the church, we're talking about the culture in Corinth inside of the church. Because Paul opens up in that first chapter and says, why are you guys dividing yourselves on the basis of who baptized you? He even goes on to say, I'm glad that I didn't baptize any of you with the exception of two people. And then later down the line, Nate, he says, hey, don't be divided about who you, quote, follow. I of Paul, I of Peter, I of Apollos, I of Christ. And then we see in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, you have brothers and sisters not waiting on each other for the Lord's Supper. Actually using the Lord's Supper as an opportunity to become inebriated, intoxicated. And then we see in chapter 12, Paul addresses this issue of spiritual gifts. And from chapter 12 to chapter 14, Paul is going to comment on these spiritual gifts. And basically in chapter 12 and chapter 14, what Paul is going to say is, hey, just because you have this gift, this miraculous spiritual gift, does not mean that you're better than anybody. That actually the person who has tongues and the person who has the ability to speak in prophecy and the person who has special knowledge, guess what that makes you? Still a Christian. The person who doesn't possess these, guess what that makes them? Still a Christian. He would even go on later to say in chapter 12, towards the end of the chapter, that the person who you would regard as least honorable actually gets the most honor. Because the church is one body with many members on one mission. And so we come to chapter 13, which is sandwiched between 12 and 14, for good reason. I do not believe that Paul puts this here by coincidence. Because in this conversation about division, in this conversation about overall unity, in this conversation about miraculous spiritual gifts, Paul gives an entire chapter to love. An entire chapter to love. And one of the questions that is most pondered, most talked about, whether that's between friends, whether that's among family members, whether that's in college sociological studies, is the question, what is love? What is love? You know, some people think that love is just a byproduct of chemical reactions produced over millions and millions of years so that you and I can survive. Some people say that love is the highest virtue that we possess. But the thing about love is that it's really hard sometimes to quantify. Can anybody reach into their pocket and pull me out five stacks of love? Can anybody reach into a jar and pull out love? If you went to a science lab, you say, hey, could you run an experiment and the end product be love? When you sit down on Santa's knee, right, and he asks you what you want for Christmas, could you look into his eyes and say, hey, I'd like for you to reach into your bag of toys and pull me out love? You get the drift? And so what is this thing called love? In the Bible, the highest form of this word is agape, which means, hey, serving the interest, what's the best interest for someone else outside of yourself. But I like to qualify or quantify love as this simple statement that Paul is going to talk about here. Love doesn't sit. Love does. Love does. Love is a verb. That's the point that Paul makes. Love is a verb. And so as he opens up this chapter and he mentions in passing, as we're going to move through this chapter, he's going to talk about how love fits in with those spiritual gifts. And he starts right out of the gate. If I speak in tongues of men and angels. See, hey, that's not a coincidence there either. The reason that he posts that there, the reason that he puts that to, pen to papyrus, right, is because this was part of the dominant conversation. The person who had tongues would say, I'm better than you because I can do this. And Paul says, hey, it doesn't matter if you speak with the tongues of angels, but if you don't have love, you're a noisy gong. You're a clanging cymbal. You are just noise. You're just noise without love. And these are the things that you aren't unless you have love. And if I have prophetic powers, up there's another gift that's mentioned. Tongues, prophecy, fits right in with what's being talked about in chapter 12. It fits right in what's being talked about in chapter 14. If I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and knowledge, there's the other gift that was being sought after and held over the heads of brothers and sisters that didn't have it. And if I have all faith, this special faith, so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. Be the greatest preacher in the world, but if you don't do it with love, you're nothing. Could walk through and make the book of Numbers really, really interesting as a teacher, right? Could understand everything that's in the book of Revelation. Don't do it in love, you're nothing. Do it for your self-interest doesn't count. I could be the greatest servant in the world. I could go to every single homeless shelter and serve soup to every single homeless person in all of North Carolina. And if I did it just so I could be on the news, in the absence of love, nothing. If I give away all I have and I've delivered my body up, look at how intense this is, and I deliver my body up to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. I can set myself as an example of a martyr. And if I do it just to be remembered in the history books down the line, with no love, no purpose, no rhyme, no reason, other than self-interest, I am nothing. And what Paul is driving home to the Corinthian church is that this is what you are if the motivation for why you do what you do is absent of love. And then he talks about what love actually does do. Let's say you do have this agape love that is the center and is the cornerstone of your faith. Love is patient and love is kind. Does that sound like the Corinthian church in the first century right now? Absolutely not. There's no love displayed in using the Lord's Supper as a mockery. There's no love in trying to divide into groups or clusters on the basis of who baptized you or the basis of who you follow as a disciple. There's no love there. There's no love in not handling the sexual immorality that's taken place within the church that goes unchecked. There's no love there. Love is patient and love is kind and it does not envy and it does not boast. Boast. Get a sense of boasting in chapters 12 and chapters 14? Absolutely. culture of Corinth. And if we're not careful, it can be us as well. It does not insist on its own way. You have conversations with people. You have meetings with elders. You have meetings with deacons. You talk to the preacher. You talk to brothers and sisters. And you're, you know, wrestling with some ideas, wrestling with direction, wrestling with service, and it doesn't go your way. Are you the one that insists that it's my way or the highway? See, this is what's going on in Corinth. Paul just doesn't mention these things just for the fun of it. He's mentioning these things because this is exactly the description of what's taking place. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing. So as you look at this text and as you see what Paul says, what we can see, I can just see now, Paul's standing in the middle of Corinth in the church and he's holding up a big sign and he goes, all of these things that I'm talking about, things that you are and the things that love is and the things that love doesn't do, he's holding up a sign that says, warning, 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 Will Rogers. This is you. And what you display to the outside world and what you cultivate within your church culture at Corinth does not represent love. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things, because that's what love does. Because love is a verb. Now notice here in verse 8, see, this is where we get off sometimes, because the whole section of chapter 13 is about love, but we plant ourselves only in verses 8 through 13. See, the question was asked, how do we know that the miraculous spiritual gifts talked about here have ceased? And this is the proof text that we use. We ignore all the stuff about love, right? Because we don't want to look in the mirror and say, man, I might be deficient in some of these areas. We want to go to what we don't struggle with, right? Or just maybe a question that doesn't have any serious significance with regards to who I am and how I act and what I show the people around me. But in verse 8, it says there, love never ends. And so what Paul is going to do is he's going to contrast the eternal nature of love with the temporary nature of the miraculous spiritual gifts that this church is fighting over, that this church is divided over, that this church is judging one another by. And he says, love never ends. Now, think about that for a second. If you could possess anything, maybe your favorite shirt that would never wear out, or your dream car that would never break down, if you could possess one thing of value, and the caveat to that is, as long as you possess it, it will never cease to operate or function any differently than when you first got it. That's a pretty good deal. I'd take Joe Montana, put him in the Niners. Right now, if Joe Montana can function and operate the same way he did in the 1980s and transport him now, I'd do it in a heartbeat. Well, what about my money? What if I had more money then or more money now and it would just function and operate and it would always be there? Most people would take that. Or some of us look at, quote, the good old days. If I could just have the good old days and those good old days would continue to function and operate the way in which they did, I'd take that in a heartbeat. And for the people in Corinth, it's, I want my prophecy gift. I want my tongues gift. I want my special knowledge gift. Not because it serves the church, but because it serves me. And what I want, what I deserve, and what I get from it. Paul says, love never. so he says, for we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. And the word for perfect there is teleos, means complete, mature. It is the same word used to describe the perfect law of liberty seen in James, in which James says, once you peer into the perfect law of liberty, be hearers and doers of the word. So there is something to come later down the line that would be mature, that these gifts had a designated, designed end, as scaffolding is to a building. Once the building is complete, you no longer need the scaffolding. So gifts of the miraculous nature were to the church until the completed word was finished. It says, when I was like a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child, but when I became a man, I gave up childish ways. Ding, ding, ding. That is the message to the Corinthian church. Stop acting childish. I mean, nobody here has ever seen their kid throw a temper tantrum, right? Nobody? Nobody's ever done that? You know what it's like. You give a kid a gift or you give a kid a toy, and that toy breaks, and that toy doesn't last, or because of the misuse of the gift, it is taken away. And what happens? Believe me, I know. And Paul is telling the Corinthian church, grow up in love, not gifts. And so for us, the application for us is that regardless of what talents and abilities that God has bestowed upon us, we must use those and exercise those in a spirit of love, of agape. We use and exercise our gifts to the benefit of what is the best interest, not of myself, but of other people. If I'm an encourager, I don't go around and encourage people that are hurting just so I can go back and tell all my friends, guess what? I encouraged 50 people this week, and look at what I've done. If I'm a servant, I don't use my service as leverage against other people in the church. I don't say, hey, you remember that one time I gave you 30 bucks when you needed gas? Well, hey, guess what? You owe me. I don't use my service to say, hey, guess what? Did you see how sharply dressed I was on the Lord's table over here? I was on the Lord's table. I don't know about all these other heathens in here, but I was on the Lord's table. I said open prayer. Now, hey, I taught class. I'm good. I'm better than A, B, C, or D who doesn't do that stuff. So that's not love. And that's not what love does. That's not the essence of love being a verb. And notice what he says at the end of the section. So now faith, hope, and love abide, dwell, live, encompass yourself in these three. I mean, what would the church look like? Or what does a church look like that simply dwells and lives and communes in the spirit of faith, hope, and love? You know what they don't look like? Corinth. They don't look like Corinth. They don't look like Crete. They look like the body of Christ. They represent and demonstrate through the gifts and abilities that have been given the insurmountable love of what took place on the cross. I mean, think about this for a second. Christ came not to be served, but to serve. And in each and every situation where we find him engaging people, whether that's running people out of the temple, whether that's handling a prostitute and her situation, talking with Pharisees, engaging with blind men, talking to men by demons. He always acts out of the best interest of the person involved, not because he wants to be king. It's actually the situation where he does something miraculous and he tried to make a king and he leaves. And too often when we do stuff, when we use our talents, when we use our gifts, when we use our abilities, we want people to crown us. And I think what Paul would say would be something like this. Congratulations for doing what the gospel commissioned you to do. And he might add, do you want to go? I don't know. But that is the essence of what Jesus' love demonstrated on the cross. And so he says, Paul says, abide in these three, but the greatest of these, is love. And why is that? Because faith and hope are predicated on love. I hope that the faith that you have, whether that's the way in which you engage people around you, the way in which you engage your brothers and sisters, I hope that the faith that stems out of your being is on the basis of the love that was demonstrated by Christ on the cross 2,000 years ago. I pray that the hope that you have, not the, oh man, it's going to rain, but the confident expectation of what is to come is predicated on the love of God, and on the basis of His love, we can be confident in the promises that He makes. And see, the problem with the Corinthian church is they're not there. They're placing their hope in themselves. They're placing their faith in the gift that they've been given. And their love is for self and nobody else. And so this idea of agape seems to be foreign. They're not willing to inconvenience themselves. They're not willing to step aside for the greater good of the church. But instead, they're dysfunctional, hedonistic, and place their own desires and wants above that of the body. And that is not the description of Christ is supposed to be. Think about that again for a second. What if any marriage were to function the way that this body, this bride, is functioning towards its groom? It'd be crazy. There is no way that anybody here, hopefully anybody here that's married, would just allow their spouse to do whatever they wanted. I mean, could you imagine? I don't know what would happen if I decided to go out and just do whatever I wanted behind my wife's back, and then she found out and she goes, well, why are you doing that? And I came to her and I said, well, it's just out of love. And then looked at her in the face and said, well, what do you mean? I'm doing this because I love you. Any woman here can accept that from their husband? Any man can accept that from their wife? Then why would we think that Christ would accept that from His bride, the church? So the greatest of these is love. Then at the beginning of chapter 14, the first two words that Paul uses is pursue love. So does 1 Corinthians 13 demonstrate that miraculous spiritual gifts would at one point pass away? Yes. Is that the point of 1 Corinthians 13? Absolutely not. And so the question that I have for us tonight is, when we understand and grab a hold of our niche in in the church, the gifts and abilities that we have, like we talked about this morning, and we parlay that into a ministry. Next question I have is why? Why do you do what you do? Because I know a bunch of people, not here, but in general, who are preachers, elders, deacons, and servants. Because they have to be. Not because they want to be. They have to love people. They don't necessarily want to love people. And if we combine the skills and abilities that God has given us, and we pair that with the love that is seen and expressed by Jesus in the New Testament, we don't have to worry. We don't ask the question, is the church ever going to grow? We'll ask the question, how big is this thing going to get? What else can we do? Who else can we fit? See, that's the interesting thing about the church. It's the only organization where the number of people is not set at a standard quota. There are corporations in America that say, no, in order for us to be successful, we can only have X amount of employees, church. I like that. Come one, come all. And so my question as we wrap this up, two questions. Are you utilizing the gifts and skills and abilities God has given you? And if you already have figured that out, are you doing it out of love? Are you doing it because you have to? Or does love compel you to want to? To answer those two questions are crucial because they demonstrate your relationship with Jesus. And if maybe you've been a little bit too self-centered, maybe it's time to get back as the bride of Christ. It's time to get back to the groom who purchased us with a price. Is that something you'd like to do tonight? Let's go ahead and do that this evening as we stand.